So we've just completed a lecture on the family. But the family is a big issue. And for that reason, we've decided to break that discussion into two parts. So at this stage, we're now look at the second part of the issue. So in this lecture, we intend to look at the African family as a mechanism for addressing inequalities and imbalances. We want to look at the African family and foreign exchange flows, the ideology of the African family and business management, as well as African family and property devolution. And we shall end by looking at the issue of intestate succession laws. Now, the question of economic inequalities and imbalances. These are a reality as far as African societies are concerned. We find inequalities within the family, we find inequalities within the community, we find inequalities between the haves and the have-nots. Within the country too, we find inequalities. It's a polarization between the rural areas and the urban areas. Globally, there are inequalities in wealth. There's the global north, which is supposed to be better endowed, has resources, more resources, as opposed to the global south. So what you find is that very often the well-off are usually unwilling to share with those who are not so well-off. Unless, of course, there is a motive. So motives are necessary if rich people will share their wealth with poorer people. Taxation is one way of making this possible. But we do know that taxes are not popular, especially in African countries. Charity also does not work because people do not understand why they should be charitable to someone, especially if the person is not close to them. There must be a reason for that charity. Okay? Therefore, there is a need for a way. And invariably, the African family is that way. So directly or directly, through the mechanism of the African family, you find that resources are flowing from wealthier settings to deprived settings, from urban areas to rural areas, from the Western world to Africa. And all that because the family compels the well-to-do to share with the less well-off. In any case, it is the basis for making claims on the well-off. Within the family, the well-off do support the poor in various ways, directly and indirectly. And all this is through the family. There is a moral obligation which compels people to address poverty if they have the means. There's also the question of past and future reciprocities. In other words, if you are well off today, maybe somebody made you well off in the past. Therefore, you address that generosity. You also take care of someone who is poor because nobody knows tomorrow. So despite the desire to earn prestige and influence within the family, it's also a factor. If you want to be taken seriously within your family, let them see how generous you are. So rich members, in fact, who do not share, often do not enjoy the goodwill of their kith and kin. What is also interesting is that the fear of witchcraft and sorcery compel people to be generous to their family members, even when they don't want to be generous. Now, the same also can be said as far as the imbalance between the rural and the urban areas are concerned. Historically, in the past, our rural areas have been deprived as opposed to the urban areas. Okay? The urban areas are more or less like the center of attraction for the best in the country. So the good things in the rural areas find themselves drifting to the urban areas where all the resources, the opportunities reside. So it creates a kind of imbalance. Okay? But this imbalance is compensated for by the transfer of resources from the urban area to the rural areas. And this takes the form of money transfers. Okay? People who are getting better salaries in urban areas are mindful of the fact that either they have investments in the rural areas, buildings and so on, and businesses, or they have relatives in the urban areas, in the rural areas, who are in need. And sometimes they do support the rural context in terms of certain ritual activities and social activities, for example, funerals and so on and so forth. Now, the other type of transfer that I want to draw attention to, if what happens when people make transfers from overseas to the countries in the third world, you'll find that many Africans working and earning good salaries outside Africa consistently make remittances to families in Africa. They support institutions, they build mansions, and of course, sometimes they're doing this so that when they return, they have a place to stay. But that is also generating an income as far as the local people are concerned. And these remittances, whether we like it or not, the truth of the matter is that they help countries like Ghana, Nigeria, and so on and so forth to balance their budgets. Footballers like Asamoah Gyan, Drogba, Didier Drogba, medical doctors, and so on and so forth, all of these people are making remittances all the time. And the report is that these remittances are so large, they come in foreign exchange, they go directly to households. And this means that the transfers have a significant impact on poverty reduction, funding for housing, education, basic essential needs, and even business investments. Now, let's look at it from another perspective, the question of business. And you could say that to a certain extent, business in Africa, as in everywhere else, grows when it is found within a conducive environment. And the family provides that conducive environment for business to grow. Okay? And here we are talking about not only private business, but also public business. We talk about small business and light business. We talk about family business, for example. All of these things are supported by the family. But having said this, that the family is a positive instrument for growing business, for supporting business, for bringing about business, let us also not forget that the African family is like a double-edged sword. It can be an asset, but it can also be a hindrance. So it can promote business, there's no doubt about that. So for example, the reciprocity that we consider as the norm within the family, the fact that there's accountability within the family, there's goodwill within the family, there's trust within the family, all of these are potential assets that can be exploited to establish and to grow business. For example, there's nothing preventing a family from pooling its resources and generating the necessary capital to start a business or to manage it. Okay? Family assets can serve as collateral when it comes to seeking bank loans. And indeed, history provides many examples of how business ventures have succeeded due to the family and due to family ideology. But on the other side of the coin is that the strong nepotism, you see, the strong loyalty to the family generates nepotism. And this may not always be good as far as business is concerned. Nepotism, strong loyalty means nepotism, and nepotism leads to corruption. So that also does not do well, does not augur well as far as business is concerned. And if you have a system where family interest far outweighs in people, family loyalty far outweighs that to the state, you can imagine a context where family interest clashes with the state or official interest, people will naturally vote for the family rather than for the country, and that is not good. And that is what explains embezzlements, misallocations of resources, and so on and so forth. The fact that sometimes ethnic mates, family mates, and so on and so forth are privileged when it comes to decision making and the allocation of public resources at the expense of people who are more competent. There is also the question of the longevity of a business. Sometimes our businesses become ephemeral businesses. They don't last because our family systems are very ambivalent about who the successor should be. So one person maybe is a very successful entrepreneur. On his death, the family takes over, and there's bickering as to who should succeed, and so on and so forth. And before long, the business collapses. Sometimes a child who is closely attached to the parent and therefore has monitored the parent's behavior and knows the way the parent manages the business may not be allowed to succeed because that child is not a member of the family. When the lineage comes in, the lineage prefers some other person, okay, who is not directly connected to the dead person, okay? For example, that person's nephew or niece is the person the family will select, and that person, because of lack of experience, is going to run the business down. The result, of course, is that successors often mismanage and kill businesses in Africa. Now, we consider the question of transmission of resources, the question of inheritance and succession. Now, how property is managed has implications for conflict and peace within the family itself, as well as within the wider society. And therefore, societies have rules and regulations which prescribe how property, whether joint property or private property, should be accessed, used, and disbursed or distributed. Today, these concerns affect individual rights, the rights of children, women, and so on and so forth. And these rights are infringed by the traditional rules of inheritance that society has put in place. But that is how the law it works. And because of all this, countries have introduced laws to regulate property succession. So let's take, for example, self-acquired property. Self-acquired property is a property that a person has acquired through his sweat. So that kind of property is his bona fide property to do as he pleases, so long as he lives. So he can choose to use his property the way he likes. But the question is how that property is going to be disposed of when the person dies. And such property becomes joint property on the person's death. That's not surprising, because an individual is himself property, okay? So if you have property, and you have property and you die, your owner is going to take over your property. It seems logical from the African perspective. So when death occurs, the lineage collectively, or the family if you like, may lay claim to self-acquired property. It may then prescribe who the heir is, the next of kin. And different societies look at this differently, okay? And invariably, the inheritors are lineage members, and they have to be lineage members because the lineage will not allow outsiders to come in and take over property. And that means that if the children of the deceased are not considered as members of the lineage will not let them. And we find consistently that when it comes to property, there are certain kinds of exclusion which are based on gender. So when a man dies, his widow in a patrilineal society is a non-inheritor. She cannot take over the person's property. Daughters are very often not allowed to inherit. Sisters are not allowed to inherit. In terms of legal, societal norms, these people are denied. And this denial of women's inheritance rights, you'll find in many parts of Africa. For example, looking at BBC, you come across a statement made by somebody called Simba. Simba from Harare, Zimbabwe, has this to say. She says that for many women, the death of their husbands means the beginning of abject poverty. In other words, whatever the husband has is taken away from them. And somebody called Imbior from Southern Sudan has this to say. She says that in my tribe, the Dinka, any property left by parents who die gets inherited by the older son. If no son, but only daughters, the sons of the daughter's uncle, that is their father's brother, will inherit the property. Women don't own property in Dinka Abor culture. So these kinds of things are common throughout Africa. In terms of matrilineal succession, you find that the next of kin for the purpose of inheritance and succession are the brothers, sometimes also the sisters of the deceased. The sister's children are also the nephews and nieces may be entitled. But some other member of the lineage may be appointed. Okay? But traditionally, the lineage could select a suitable person to inherit a dead person's property, and that is both assets and liabilities. Of course, this is changing in today's Africa, but there are still pockets of resistance when it comes to all these things. So in the matrilineal context, we have seen who is entitled, but who is it who is not entitled? Children do not automatically inherit their deceased father in matrilineal societies. Widows and widowers do not inherit the spouse. Okay, the father cannot inherit the children. So as a result, individual rights seem to be undermined by some of the laws that we have in African societies, and it therefore leads to injustice. And these kinds of injustices have brought about the need to have laws of intestate succession. One of these laws, which is a law, PNDC Law 111, dated back to 1985. I believe this law is under revision. I'm not sure whether it has been revised or not. This law attempts to address the problem. It attempts to defend the rights of the orphan, the widow, and the widower. How does it do that? Now, let us understand that this law comes into the rescue of the nuclear family. And that's what it does. It stipulates that where the estate, and when we talk about estate here, ladies and gentlemen, we're not talking about an estate house. We're talking about property here. So where the estate of the deceased includes only one house, the surviving spouse or child, or both of them, shall be entitled to that house. B, where the estate includes more than one house, the surviving spouse or child, or both of them, shall determine which house of these houses shall devolve to such spouse or child. So the law also stipulates that the residue of the estate, whatever remains, shall be shared out in a certain way. So in other words, 3 portions out of 16 of the estate shall go to the surviving spouse. In other words, the surviving spouse, whether it's a widow or a widower, is entitled to less than 1/4 of the property. On the other hand, the surviving children take 9 portions out of 16. And that means they take more than half of the estate. The surviving parent, however, is entitled to 1/8 of the property. And the remaining 1/8 of the property shall be distributed according to law in accordance with the customs of the people. So you can see that this law attempts to bring in certain members of the family who would have been excluded. The widows are being taken care of, orphans are being taken care of, even the parent of the person is also taken care of. You will find that the law also prescribes that if there is no surviving parent, then a quarter of the property shall be distributed according to the customary law. In other words, what should belong to a surviving parent should now be added to what is due to the family. If the deceased is not survived by a spouse, about 3/4 of the property of the estate shall go to the children. So the children benefit when there is no widow. Okay. However, in the absence of a widow or a widower, an orphan, then the surviving parent earns about 3/4 of the property, which means that whether you are talking about a matrilineal society or a patrilineal society, a parent, if that parent has lost a child, is entitled to the bulk of the property that the parent has left behind, so long as that child does not himself have a widow, does not have children. So the diagram the table that you see here explains the different proportions as contained in the law. So the point to note is that PNDC Law 111 applies where a person dies intestate. So in other words, if the person did not die intestate, well, it's a different matter. Okay, if the person has made a will before his death, the law may or may not come into effect. I don't know, unless of course it's contested. The law makes it possible for a large bulk of the father's estate to go to the surviving children and the widow. And you remember that in the matrilineal societies, that is not on. The husbands, that is the widower, are also entitled to claim a portion of their wife's property if the wife dies. And the surviving parent, who would otherwise have had to be cared for by his child, his children, also is not denied. That person also gets a share of the property. So this brings to an end the discussion on the family.